I thank you for this day. I just ask that you watch over us today. Help us have a good day. Speak your Jose today. Tell us what we need to know. I just ask you to help us have a good week this week. Coming off a break. And I just thank you for everything. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
I do want to ask, does anybody have anything that is on their heart that they want to share, that maybe they're being asked to speak, read? Well, then I'm going to put you on the spot. Will you come read Psalm 95?
Who, me?
Yes, you.
Since you started this morning.
Oh, my goodness, yes.
So, I was a part of the Bible study this morning for a short period of time, and welcome. And they, for whatever reason, Ruth Ann took us to Psalm 95, and earlier that morning, a friend of mine had posted a verse out of Psalm 95. And we're going to be talking about testing the spirit today. And so that was kind of one of those things where when the spirit is sending you to Psalm 95, you know, three times, then, well, you might as well go there and read it. So we're going to start off that way.
Okay, thank you. Am I on here? Okay, thanks. Oh, come, let us, Psalm 95. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to him with songs. For the Lord is the great God, and the great God above all gods. In his hand are the deep places of the earth. For he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion, as in the day of trial in the wilderness, when your fathers tested me. They tried me, though they saw my work. For 40 years I was grieved with that generation and said, it is a people who go astray in their hearts, and they do not know my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter rest. They shall not enter rest.
I think that that's something we're going to have to keep reading and reading and reading and reading. Very interesting, though. It fit in with the morning Bible study, and then it also is some of the same words are going to be is what we're going to talk about today. So today, and I think this year, we should be reading 1 Thessalonians. What I mean by this year is when we read 1 Thessalonians, we understand a church who is turning from their previous idols over to God. Where we are right now in California, I would say that we are not the majority. We are the minority. As far as believers in the triune God, as believers in God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. As we read some of these books, like Thessalonians, we can relate. They talk about turning from idols, turning from sin, And we can see that happening around us. But I don't want to downplay the fight that the Thessalonians were having. As we read in Thessalonians, I want to understand what type of letter is being written to a certain group of people. Now, they're being ruled by the Romans, by Caesar, and there's a lot of God worshiping, little g. So, all the Greek gods. And if you know anything about Greek mythology, you know that these gods are powerful beings that one of the things in Greek mythology is you don't want to anger the gods. And so they've created for themselves these gods, which is what they want to be praying to because they think that that's what will come and free them from this Roman rule. And it's everywhere around them. It's in their buildings. It's the way their temples are built. It's all around this type of life, where everything is about this, these Greek gods. It's interesting that this week we watched, I don't know if you've seen it, but My Big Fat Greek Wedding. It's a funny movie, it's a great movie. And they believe in Jesus and they love God, but they also have no problem putting up these idols of these Greek gods. So, interesting that I watched My Big Fat Greek Wedding this week, and then I'm studying in Thessalonians, trying to understand this letter that's being written to them, and the fight that they're actually going. Every time they step out of their house, what they're being pushed in front of their faces is Greek gods, Greek gods, Greek gods. And there's a little tiny church in this big town of Thessalonica. And it's the church that was established by Paul. Now, if you would, for a moment, think about this little church. And Paul has gone around and told everybody that the one true God was on earth, was crucified, paid the ultimate price for them, and offers them freedom from their sins and eternal life in heaven. And so they are choosing a different Lord. They are choosing a different king other than Caesar. Not making Caesar very happy. So when Paul writes to them, he starts off with a prayer. First off, it says Paul. Oh, so First Thessalonians. Chapter 1, verse 1. We're going to read the whole chapter. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians, in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing your work of faith, labor of love, and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of our God the Father. Knowing, beloved brethren, your election by God, for our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance, as you know what kind of men we were among you for your sake. And you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction, I'm going to stop right there. He's talking about the Lord having received the word in much affliction. I'm going to stop right there. He's talking about when he was among them. And the reason he's no longer among them is because the Romans killed us, and of the Lord having received the word in much affliction, with joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became examples to all in Macedonia and Achaia, who believe, for from you the word of the Lord has sounded forth, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith toward God has gone out, so that we do not need to say anything, for they themselves declare concerning us what manner from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. Delivers us from the wrath to come. I would say that's quite a bit of competition to Caesar. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus Christ direct our way to you, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love to one another and to all, just as we do with or to you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. Coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. What a great accusation that they are living every day for the one true God. Now I guarantee you that these Thessalonians are struggling. We're going to read a little bit about their struggle, but his first epistle to the church. So, chapter 5. But concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them, as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing. And edify one another, just as you also are doing. This morning in the Bible study that I was only a part of for a short period of time, but I was asked a question, and I said, did you somehow know what I was about to read? Did you know what I was going to talk about today? Because I was asked, what was the question?
What does God's rest mean to
God's
you?
God's rest. Yes. God's rest. And here we're talking about sleeping and rest. And the answer is this. Comfort each other and edify one another. And up top where it says, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Sounds like God. And it's Ruth Ann's fault that we're being interrupted. And we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Be at peace among yourselves. In love for their work's sake. Be at peace with those who are unruly. Comfort the faint-hearted. Uphold the weak. Be patient with all. See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good, both for yourselves and for all. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophecies. Test all things. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Abstain from self. Sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. Brethren, pray for us. Greet all the brethren with a holy kiss. I charge you by the Lord that this epistle be read to all the holy brethren. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. So, this kind of reminds me of when the Messiah was talking to his apostles, his disciples, and he says, I speak to everybody else in parables because you guys already understand. And they're like, we don't understand though. And when Paul is writing to his church, if we can imagine their everyday struggle with being the only church who's following Jesus as the Messiah, who's understanding that Yeshua, who walked on the earth, was God, and that he is the only way to get to heaven. But Paul is writing to them saying, this is what you should be doing. And it's not easy. It's just the next line. I put it in there. There we go. 16, by itself, rejoice always. That's it. Rejoice. 16, by itself, rejoice always. That's it. Rejoice always. Everybody do that right now. Just rejoice always.
Rejoice always.
Without ceasing. Go right ahead, guys. Just do it. In everything, give thanks. In everything. I mean, we're talking about always. Everything. Without ceasing. And then he says, the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. He says, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. That is what we should be doing. He wrote this knowing that the moment they walk out of their house, this is the hardest thing they could do. Because they're already the minority. They are already being kicked out for their faith by the Romans. And they're supposed to rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and give thanks for everything. For that is the will of God in Christ Jesus for them. Quench the Spirit. What's he talking about? He follows it by saying, do not despise prophecies. Test all things. Hold fast what is good. And abstain from every form of evil. Abstain from every form of evil. I'm going to say that there are prophecies out right now from different prophets. I can't say that they aren't prophets. I can't say that they are. What I can say is that we are to listen, to not despise the prophecies. So we are to listen to them, and then we are to test them. A lot of these prophecies that are out, we actually want what they're prophesying to come true. But that has nothing, or it may not have anything to do with God's will for us. Because he's talking to a people who God's will for them is to give thanks and rejoice in their suffering. Because they are suffering. And I can't say for sure because I wasn't there, but I'm guessing that there's a lot of people trying to get them to move away from the church. Trying to give them something that they want to pull them away. And we have to test it. We don't want to not listen to a prophecy if it is from God. Last week we talked a little bit about unity. And unity doesn't mean that we need to unify ourselves, the church, with those who don't believe. No, we need to unify ourselves as the believers in God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I can tell you that God is using this church right now. I have a story that happened this week. It's a very interesting story. Last Sunday, after we left, we had a great lunch, good service, big turnout, and we all went home to our very safe homes. And when the sun went down, I'm sure most of us were inside of our homes, and it was very quiet. But there was a shooting in Gridley, and somebody was on the railroad tracks near Laurel Street, which is two streets over, in between Virginia and Washington. Well, that's where the railroad tracks run, between Virginia and Washington. So, backtrack to last Friday. As you guys can see by the zero leaves outside, get ready. I've been picking up leaves every day this week. blowing, raking, shoveling, mowing. Every day except for Thursday, because it was Thanksgiving, and Saturday, because Vern did it. So, one of the days, I was out picking up leaves, and I see this man, and he had on a Carhartt jacket, and he was wearing glasses. And he was walking in front of my house, with his head down, and he was walking with a purpose. And I looked over at him and I said, "Hey, Bill." And he looked up at me, smiled, came over, gave me a hug. And I said, "How are you doing?" And he said, "Not good." I said, "What's up?" And he says, "Oh, I'm trying to stay out of trouble." And I said, "How's that going?" He says, "Not very good." So then, I said, "Hey, weird thing, I am the new pastor of this church. You should come check us out on Sunday." And he's like, "You know what, I'll try it." He says, "I gotta go." So he gave me a hug again, and he was off. That, if I don't know what would have happened if he would have came to church on Sunday. I don't know if things would have been different. I do know that that was on purpose. That man crossed my path because he was a friend of mine. As I told you guys in the past, I like to get in fights. And a couple of times when I was going to get into a fight, I would look back and he was there watching my back, making sure somebody else didn't get in on the other side to fight. And he was always, not always, but he was there a couple of times to even the odds. He was a friend. Now, he was not the greatest type of guy. What he was into was probably really bad. And I think God was trying to reach him one last time. And he said no. That was the man that was shot and killed. I've been wrestling with this since it happened. My wife said, "Are you okay?" I said, "I don't know. I think I did everything I was supposed to do, other than grab him and tackle him and say, 'No, you're coming to church.'" Which by now he could probably beat me up. But it made me realize, though, that we have a fight. There's a lot of reasons to come to church. There's a lot of reasons to have a relationship with God. But how do you convince somebody who has that many more reasons to not come to church, that have that many more reasons to stay out there and listen to the world? The world wants us to be at an unrest. There's a fight right now. Paul was fighting against this evil that was trying to draw people away from the message he was out to deliver. Paul wanted to fight this evil. Jesus showed up to fight this evil. People need to understand that man is inherently evil, and the things that man chases after, if it's not God, is probably evil. It's drawing us away. It makes him feel good for a little bit. We need to test everything. That's what we're told to do. Test everything. That's why when this morning when A friend of mine had shared Psalms and Psalms 95. And Ruth Ann study takes us to Psalm 95. I think we're supposed to read it. Those tests. We need to pass those tests. Father God Almighty, Lord, I just thank you and praise you for who you are, Lord. I thank you and praise you for this church, for sending your son to die for us, to die for our sins. I ask that you would give us courage and strength, Lord, to continue to follow you, to truly follow you, to continue to seek your word, to study through it, to continue to have a relationship with you. Lord, give us courage and strength to turn away from the things of the world and to truly follow you, to walk out these doors and know that we are the minority, Lord, but we're seeking after you. And we'd rather do that and be minority than to be a part of the masses and be the majority. I thank you for this church. I thank you for these people. Lord, guide us. Bless us. In the name of the Messiah, amen.
Amen.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.